By now, you should at least know several of the beginning words of John 1.
Right.
We want to go to Genesis 1.
Are we still continuing in the Word was with God, or?
Yes, we will be discussing the Word was with.
Okay.
Okay? In fact, John says the Word was with. But Genesis 1, especially verse 2, we'll start at verse 1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And notice verse 2, and the earth was without. The earth was without form and void. Darkness was upon the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. And God said, let there be light. And there was light. And God saw the light that it was good. And God divided the light from the darkness. Okay. Notice that the Word is with, and the earth is without. Okay? And of course, until you know the Word, because the Word is with, until you know the Word that is with God. Because some of us seem to know the Word, but we know the Word as taught by our denomination, our religious background, our past. You know what I'm saying? We need to know the Word that is with God. That's the Word we need to know. And until you know the Word that is with God, you haven't even reached the first day. You haven't come to the first day. Okay. The phrase darkness was upon the face of the deep, this signifies evil. And it draws a division between the two minds, the mind of Christ and the carnal mind. Okay. So it says, darkness was upon the face of the deep. The earth was without form and void. This is not just talking about the chaos from which God flung the universe. This has specific reference to us to see that there is without form, there's void, there's darkness. The Spirit of God begins to move, and God speaks the Word, and light is the result. So it is drawing a contrast between the carnal mind in darkness and the mind of Christ. And say, brother, you take a lot of liberty in what you say. I don't know how you can really say that this is saying that. Okay, turn with me to Jeremiah chapter 4. You'll know where I get my other call. Jeremiah chapter 4. Notice this as we read, when I tell you the scripture, notice as we read the context of the scriptures, okay? Let's read verse 22. We'll read 22 and 23. For my people are foolish. Whose people? God's people. They have not known me. Are they his people? What is the problem? They don't know him. They are stupid children. That's my translation. And they have no understanding. They are wise to do evil, but to do good they have no knowledge. Verse 23. I beheld the earth, and lo, it was without form and void, and the heavens, and they had no life. Sound familiar? And you take a lot of liberty with the scriptures. No, I go and in the multitude of counselors, I find me. There's one counselor, Genesis 1:2. Here's another counselor, Genesis 4:23. Yes. So, Genesis starts by dividing heaven and earth. Huh? The two minds, the sense realm and the spirit realm. It begins by dividing the two realms, heaven and earth, the sense realm and the spirit realm. Notice it doesn't begin by bringing them together. It begins by dividing them. We're the ones that keep bringing them together. The earth was devoid of heavenly light and was without form. time was born. This was its stake, okay? The carnal mind, as described in Romans 8, is enmity. It is an enemy of God. So the word was, it says in John 1:1, that the earth is without. So what does the earth need? The word, which will begin to divide the two realms and bring forth life. Verse 3 said, let there be light. Okay? Let there be light. How did that take place? The word. God didn't go. He said, let there be light. Do you see what I'm saying? It was the word, not just a creative act. In fact, this doesn't even describe itself as a creative act. He didn't say, light be, in the sense of creating and bringing it in. He said, let it be. See what I mean? Check it out all the way through Genesis as he creates his creative acts, he says, and God made. But this one, he says, let there be light. So, God does not do a creative act. We must learn to let it be. First must come heavenly knowledge in the form of light. Of course, first must come the Word. In the beginning is the Word. From the Word, what came forth? Light. When the Word was spoken, light came forth. This is nothing more than God's spoken Word. Light comes from the Word, the heavenly realm. Because where does light emanate from? Does it emanate from earth? No. It emanates from the sun, which for us on the earth is the heavenly realm. Right? It doesn't emanate from the earth. It emanates from the sun. It emanates from the heavenly realm. It emanates from the spirit realm. So no wonder we walk in darkness. To walk in the senses is to walk in darkness. Anybody ever heard that phrase before? To walk in the sense realm is to walk in darkness. If we ever recognize that, it would devastate us and then cause us to run to God. Because most of our understanding, I was telling Deb last night, I said, you know, I'm learning to pick lead, play guitar, and all I'm doing is scales. I'm not doing anything, but I'm just playing these scales over and over and over. And I discovered something last night. I sat down, got a few minutes, and I started playing these scales, and I'm going, and I'm starting getting pretty good on this one, you know, really running it pretty good and everything. And so I stood up for a while, and I decided to look around and play, and without me looking at it, my playing ability was cut in half. I had to see where I was going. And then I remembered when we had the Great Rock Band, our lead guitarist was Brian, and Brian always played like this. Anybody ever know him? He never played any other way. Have anybody ever seen Eric Clapton play? And I said, that's the difference between good one and the bad one. And that it was good at the very beginning not to train myself to have to see. But because I said, because I became, at first I became angry at myself. I could go just like this, and then I went, and I said, wait a minute, the frets are exactly the same place they always were. The notes that I'm supposed to play have not changed. My fingers are going all in those places. Nothing has changed except that I can see, but it's exactly the same distances. And so I became angry with myself. I said, this is dumb. You should, and it should not cut your playing in half. The fretboard isn't going large and small and stuff on me while I'm, whoa, 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 you know what I mean? And so I said, this would be good from the very beginning if I started learning to go like this and have a feel for it. And I don't just mean go by feelings, but I mean for what is. To know what is and to trust it's there see it. But I definitely, the rest of the night, every time I've tried, you know, looking away or whatever, sometimes I'd get off, I'd have to look, get back on, look away, and go, you know, this is really bad. And it is. Because I realized that we have to see before we can, before the truths are true, the fretboard is exactly the same, you know. I mean, it's almost like the fretboard isn't, unless we can see. But it's exactly the same. By seeing it doesn't make it the same. Okay. So, this is the way we are. We walk in the sense realm, which is to walk in darkness. It is to walk in darkness. We say we see, but Jesus said, you are in darkness, and you are blind. But if you say you don't see, then I will begin to make you to see. And you will now see, not just because you see, but because I made you to see. Everybody can say, I see. But this man can say, yeah, I'm talking about, I jumped over to John 9. Because I quoted the scripture from now on, I'll give my references. Well, in John 9, where he healed the blind man. And all men can say they can see, but this man can say, I see because Jesus let me see. Jesus opened my eyes. Now, I think that's a better testimony. He can say, all can say this, but I see because Jesus opened my eyes. And if Jesus is the center, or is seeing what it's all about, you know. I mean, if seeing what it's all about, you can read somebody's book or get some certain preacher or whatever. But if seeing by Christ is what it's all about. Because everything must emanate from him. Christ must be the center, must be the focus, must be the fullness of anything that I'm about. If you're going to know about me, it must have come first from him. So the carnal mind is enmity with God. Let's see, let there be light. First must come heavenly knowledge in the form of light. Okay, this is the difference. We get knowledge through our brain. But we get light in our spirit. You know, God is spirit. And God is light. Yeah. Light comes from the Word, which is from the heavenly realm. And I think that's where we mess up. We think this is an earthly reality. We constantly try to apply it into the sense realm. Jesus said, the words that I speak unto you are spirit, pneuma, and they are life, zoe. They are spirit, and they are life, zoe. Not psuche, whatever it is. Not soul. He said, they're not. He says, the reason you don't understand me is the words that I speak unto you are spirit and life. And you're trying to make them flesh and soul. Is that a hand raise or are you scratching your head?
I was thinking it was on my mind that you're in the Word, but you can't be.
This isn't an option. Most of us live in. And, you know, there's, you know, I mean, there's things to be seen. It's not the best movie in the world. The language isn't the best. It's got some pretty extra things in there. But the truth of that was, I sat there the whole time the Lord dealt with me. I mean, I just, but you know, you can get in the Word, you can, you know, sit in class and be dealt with it the same way. That we are not of this world, but we sure act like it. But we're not. If we just act and believe that we're not of, but we try to, we are so of that we're trying to get this to give me some input that everything's okay and that I'm of God. So light comes from the Word. Light comes from the Word. Once this happens, this gives meaning to the earth. This is only done by the Spirit. The Spirit began to move. God said, what do you have? Two elements. The Word and the Spirit. Anybody ever read a book, I think it's called The Revelation of Christ, the True Gospel? And in that book, there's this section on the Spirit and the Word and the importance of the two. Okay? This is only done by the Spirit. This is good. Remember it says, God said it was good. This is good, for it finally makes a division between the two kinds of knowledge. Before then, the earth was just without form and void, period. It only had one kind of input, darkness. But when the Spirit began to move and the Word came forth, then light was the result. The Spirit moved. The Word came forth. Life was a result. God said it was good. Because there came a division. It says, created. And God said, let there be light. And there was light. And God saw the light that it was good. And God divided the light from the darkness. But the light was good. And then with it, he divided the light from the darkness. Now you go, okay, I don't understand, you know, I mean, wait a minute. Better than you get off into all these things about, you know, well, he didn't create day until, you know, later on, or, you know, all this stuff. He's talking about spiritual reality. You know, and so people say, well, I just don't understand the Word of God. I think it's kind of fishy. And, you know, what's fishy is our understanding. Okay, this is good. For it finally makes a division in the two kinds of knowledge. God is so far above us. His ways are not our ways, nor his thoughts our thoughts. That's spoken in Isaiah. Okay, now, considering that thought, that his ways are not our ways, his thoughts are not our thoughts, we might make a statement like this. He is not caught up in our little ambitions, thoughts, desires, and things that have nothing to do with his plan or his son. I mean, you could say something like that, couldn't you? If his ways are so far above ours and da da da. Now, we could react negatively to a statement like that as if, oh, that God just don't care, so... You know, and you know, I mean, what's important to me is important, and, you know, I mean, we're down here struggling, and God don't care. That isn't the spirit in which it is meant. It is meant that God is of another realm. He is the being that created all things, and Satan got in there and messed up this realm and brought us down from being what God intended. That's what we call the fall, brought down to the earth, brought down to the sense realm, and man had a spirit. God made him spirit, soul, and body, and man began to walk by his soul or the sense realm. God didn't do that. So God, because he's, you know, it's kind of like ants sitting there angry at humans because we don't get down there and relate to them and understand their, you know. You know, he is what he is. He cannot, you know, and you, if you really want to think about it, Jesus became an ant, came down and walked at us. But he didn't do it so he could only feel what we feel. Yes, that's part of it, because he'll cover everybody's. But he did it so that he could reveal the invisible God. Invisible because he's not of the sense realm. He's not invisible to Jesus. He is the most visible reality to Jesus that there is. But he had to call him the invisible God to us who go by the senses. Darkness just knows darkness. So he came down here to awaken us to the light. And then John came before Jesus, pointing to the light. We'll get into that as we proceed in the Gospel of John. So, he's not caught up in our little ambitions, thoughts, and desires, and things that have nothing to do with his plan and son in this sense. That he always intended, he didn't just create this so we could get jobs and have stereos and stuff. You know. And that'd be the height of a car with a stereo. That'd be the height of existence. You know, he created this so that there's a beautiful scripture in Isaiah. It says, God didn't create the earth in vain, but he created it to be inhabited. That doesn't mean he didn't just create a ball in vain, but he wanted little warm bodies on them. That's not what that means. That's our later thing. It means he didn't create it without form and void. He created us so that because we were created of the dust of the earth, could be inhabited by his son. Created us for purpose. Not in vain. We read everything wrong. We don't see it in light of God's way of seeing. His mind, his realm, his reality. We see everything, and so everything that he speaks, even though it's spirit and life, we take it and we translate it into our understanding. And then we make religions and denominations instead of just being and knowing, just being a son of God by Christ. There is nothing higher. There is no higher thing. Did you have that?
Yeah, I was just thinking, a lot of the things that we do, we always put everything backwards. If it's a horse and buggy type situation, God created a horse and buggy type situation. Well, because we're sitting in the buggy comes first. That's the way we look at it. So the buggy is always drawing the horse because we happen to be in the buggy. That's right. The way that we view the spiritual reality.
It's always out of order. And that's why the scriptures say that these ways are not out of order. They're so far above. And yet we say, well, how can I ever attain unto that? Well, you don't attain unto it. You must enter into it through Christ. It is ours that to know the mysteries is part of the inheritance that is ours. We freely receive that. What does it say? You have received the Spirit. It says, no man knows your spirit but you. Well, and it says, even so, no man knows God save the Spirit of God. So God's in you his spirit so that you might freely know. I mean, that's cool, isn't it? That's us.
Yeah, that was always, that one statement that you said earlier, which is really important, stop seeking to have a sense of confirming your identity in Christ. I don't know if that's exactly what you said, but that's
Gosh,
how I received it.
If I did, that sounds good.
But that's how I received it, to stop having our sense of confirming our identity in Christ, which is all we do when we look on our own things out here.
Well, the next statement I wrote is kind of along that line, because I said that he's not caught up in our little ambitious thoughts, desires, things, and blah, blah. And I said, we continually ask him to bless them, our desires, our ambitions, our parents, and expect to have fellowship with God. Are you with me on what I'm saying here? It's that with thing down here. And we think we're with him, and so if we're with, then get with me here.
Yeah.
But he's going, how can you really have fellowship with me when you have that, what we used to call downward motivation? What we used to call it years and years and years ago, downward motivation instead of upward motivation. Upward. Forgetting those things which are behind, I press toward the mark of the prize of the high calling, and the original Greek there is the upward calling. Upward calling. And it is, this. It's nothing short of the spirit realm reality, but there's different ways to describe that. See, with God and his plan, and understand, and not just in his plan, because about, I say that, but then I realize that we go, well, okay, I understand your plan, and I'm with you, baby. You know what I mean? Kind of like that. You know what I mean? And that's not it either. It's like the plan has got you. I mean, maybe sometimes you go, you get frustrated and everything, you go, I'm just going to, you know, like Jonah, I'm going to run as far as I can. But you can't run from it, you know what I mean? I mean, he's in the bottom of the boat, he's in the whale, he's in, you know, he's everywhere, he's in Tarsus, he's, you know, you can't run from it, so the best thing to do is conform to it. Right, Jimmy? You can't run far enough. I mean, the best thing to do is get after it and conform to what the Lord is, what the truth is here. Frustration for us is trying to get God to do what we think he's trying to do instead of us, you know, being with him. And you can't be with him if you don't lose yourself and your understanding in that sense and say, my ways are not your ways. My understanding is so far below, you know what I mean? If the scripture says his ways are so far above, we can say, my thoughts are so far below your thoughts. Thank you that you didn't decide you were going to give me high thoughts. But you said I could have the mind of Christ, which is better than high thoughts. High thoughts are going to cut me up. The mind of Christ is one that made himself a new reputation. Smart move. Gave us the mind of Christ. Not just high upward thoughts. It may be upward motivation, but it comes from the mind of Christ. Okay, so we continue to ask him to bless them and expect to have fellowship with God. But we're not with God. We're claiming a oneness with him for our benefit. We're in this for us. You know, what can I get out of it? What is the end result for me? What is the, you know, and this is what the nature of God, this is what the cross, this is what the losing that you might gain is all about. This spirit that is other than us. It's one that is not in it for what it can give. You know, I attend the services and things that I think best fit me, but I'm really not interested in this or that or whatever. You know what I mean? I go to as much stuff as I can, not because there's some sort of legalistic spirit there. I want to be there because, number one, there might actually be a move of the Spirit I wasn't expecting, because at a time that I did not look for him, nor did I think he was going to show up, he might show up. See, we say, I'm always ready for the Lord. You know what I mean? Even our very actions, the choices that we make show, you know, what if he showed up? You know, I don't mean literally came back in the sky. I mean showed up when we weren't ready, you know. So I don't like this one. And the second motivation is that, well, God may want to use me. He may want to help somebody, bless somebody, be there for somebody. And if the ear isn't there, where is the hearing? You know what I mean? I mean, if I'm a part that's supposed to be there, that could add something, I don't go, well, let me weigh the benefits of attendance in light of what I can get out of it. And it's been my history, linearly speaking, as I check out everything, that this is really not best suited for me. Self, you know. I mean, really, it's primarily that downward motive, that what I am in this, I am with it, but it's really this with it, I'm with it, for what I can get out of it. But, now once again, you jump back into the Spirit of Christ, you jump back into the cross and the meaning of the cross, you jump back into what it means to be with God, what the mind of Christ. I mean, all these things are one, because God is one. And there's only one conclusion left and across the board in every situation, and that is that it is self-giving. It is since it's made itself with no reputation, it certainly isn't going to attend because people might think better of yourself.
So it's kind of almost like the flip side of that. The Lord's been dealing with me about being with it in a different way. That's at work. I've been going through some personal things because it seems like there's been chances for either promotions or things that would benefit me, and then it always falls through every single time. So this time, she's lost by another job. Well, all the outreaches, regardless of the itself. So, you know, if I, you know, you can choose, you know, if you ate up.
Well, it's bad because when you choose wrong, build into the wrong thing has its own snares and traps, such as, and pulls, such as, this new position has all the benefits and whatever, but it also has new responsibilities here that is going to pull me more into the world system, that is going to make me more aware of either how much money I'm getting or what a big shot I am or what, you know, or how much harder I need to work, you know, and give yourself more of that. And tendencies that wouldn't have even been tempted. Are now being tempted, and you're going, you know, and now you're, now, instead of having spiritual energy when you get into a situation that you know a ministry situation, you're drained spiritually because all you've been doing is fighting off all this temptation and junk, and you spend all of your energy offsetting instead of flowing, you know. And so that's why, you know, wise decisions, you know, when we say wise decisions, I mean, from this mind, this with God, being with God, the Word was with God, the Word's with God. When we go counter to the Word, we're not with God the way we need to be.
Yeah, just quickly, because in talking about that, that brings back, came to my thinks that, well, I'm doing the very thing that you're saying not to do, what do? Well, the answer is recognize that you're doing the wrong with. By faith move into the right thing. I mean, the reason I'm saying is because I know how we think and how we hear things, and when we hear things, we take this on upon ourselves and think, well, look at what I'm doing, that fear thing, again, that's where we are by fear,
right.
Instead of walking by faith. Well, the way you get in the wisdom of God is say, okay, God, this is what I'm doing, and I want to move in with you. And just
there's so many ways I can see for us to get off to. I mean, I remember when I was in a situation where I needed to work. And I had a choice between the battery shop and going to the state store or not working. But the situation, not just for my family, but for other believers and whatever, called for me to work. But when I weighed working, period, in light of the availability to be with the body, the availability to be in the Word, all that kind of stuff. It was the automatic answer was, don't work at all. But this nature said, no, you need to work. The question is, what's going to be your choice? Okay. So then you step, it's like, okay, you just got past that snare, you know what I mean? You missed that one. So now you step up to the next one, battery shop or this one. Then the one at the state school was my old job. They wanted me that bad. And they were, I mean, the benefits were great. The money was pretty good from the position that I had when I was out there. The money was pretty doggone good. You were over everybody. You didn't have anybody over you. I mean, it was just, you know, just go on and on and on. But it required, if not, when you got off the job, certainly your full attention when you were on that job. There was no hope to think about the Lord, much less to read the Word or minister to somebody or anything. The battery shop, on the other hand, would be just enough money to live on, no excesses, but working with a Christian brother. And, you know, so I waited to, I'm going this way. And I worked at the battery shop. And it was great because I was able to work just enough to help out the rest of the body and whatever, take care of my family, but not be sunk, you know, by that. And of course, I think that any job, I mean, you know, if you sit there, if you don't make past that first snare, you're going to go, well, any job that, you know, you have is, I mean, any job that you have is not Jesus, but it can be Jesus in you. You know what I mean? It can be Jesus in you to work that job. And sometimes people have a hard time with that, but, you know, another thing that this, you know, this is kind of tough, but it's the truth, and I just try to follow what the Lord's telling me. But another thing that we do, and it's just a fact, everybody here's had that opportunity, everybody, is that in the early going, God gives you an opportunity to get in the Word, seek Him, put the Lord first. And, you know, there's always opportunities like that. And what a tendency on our part, because we're still young and this and that, or we haven't really heard the fullness of what God's trying to do, is that we don't utilize our time, don't utilize it the way we should. And then the timing of God coincides, the spirit movement of God is on this level, and the timing of God on the linear scale is on this level, and they're meant to meet here for a purpose, if you will. I'm trying to draw it like this. So here we are, we're progressing along the timeline, and then at this juncture, this has been fill up and do this. At this juncture, it's worse. At this juncture, it's full-time ministry. You better make sure while you're working everything that you've been utilizing, and you know what I mean, and learning stuff and all that stuff, because then it's going to be really, you know, a heavy load. And, you know, well, if you don't get this, you don't do this right, then you're just, boom, you know, you're weighed under the whole thing, and you're griping about this and that and everything, and nothing makes sense and whatever. But if you flow with each season and everything, then when you reach this, this has come with this, and it all comes together. It all gels together. Now, you know, obviously we all mess up along the way. No, it doesn't totally destroy you. And just because you messed up at one juncture doesn't mean it totally offsets. And we talked about that, you know, that last time. So I'm not going to all that. You know, God is still God. And in my opinion, this is the way I always do this. If I see that I didn't use one this time this well, and then God puts me into a season, and I can identify with that. There are seasons, man, where it's ministry, 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 and then all of a sudden the ministry backs up and it's time for me to get the Word and fill up. And if I keep ministering, because let me tell you, the devil will make people have problems too, and then call you all the time. So, and if I keep doing nothing but ministering when I should be filling up, then the time comes when I'm supposed to be ministering, and now I'm really in. Okay, what do I do? I'll tell you what I did. Lord, I admit I should have been filling up here. Then I kept ministering here, and I'm just totally, you know, and I asked for a new beginning, and I asked for some grace, and I blew it, and I admit it, and I have no excuse. And you know what? God has a miraculous way of setting it back right and getting you on with what you're supposed to do. He really does. I mean, God really is not that bad. He's not. But most of us always, it's like what you're saying, Jerry, that fear thing just comes up all the time, because that's, I'm not with God, I'm not, well, you are with God, you are, God put you in His Son, you're with Him. Quit going by your circumstances and basing your, how do you say that?
It's not that you have the sense of confirm your identity in Christ.
Yeah. Stop it. Great.
First, that was kind of hard to move to. chose to go against it, I would have known it was God.
Let me finish reading this real quick. Don't make the word conform to the word, but you conform to him, the word. He's trying to get us in the word so that we can be with God. That the only way we can ascend, I wrote this, that's the only way we can ascend our ignorance. The word is on his level. Okay, so next class we're going to talk, we're going to move rapidly ahead and deal with the word was God. Father, this time, bless the word, bless our understanding of your